So let's start. Welcome to the second part of the class. We are going to cover Bayesian analysis with R and R squared. And also we'll talk about a little bit about R markdown for the rest of the afternoon. How many of you are familiar with Bayesian statistics?
Bayesian data analysis.
Great. How many of you are not familiar? So the idea of Bayesian statistics is actually very straightforward. Frequentist way that you need to deal with how different methods and how different methods work, different assumptions and different methods. It's not a case for Bayesian. You just need to understand probability and likelihood. And that's that. There are some difficulties in terms of how you do sampling from plot 2, or how you can estimate plot 2 and stuff. That is actually the part that some is from. This is a brief agenda for our RSTAN class. It's the first time that we are offering RSTAN. So I don't know exactly how much it's going to take to cover the slides, but I have about 60 slides. For some reason, I lost the page numbering. Hopefully, I can cover all of them. So I'll be starting with a brief introduction to Bayesian analysis, so that you know everyone will be and available software for Bayesian analysis. So we are talking about there's a different software that can do Bayesian analysis, but we specifically focus on RSTAN. So there are pros and cons for those software. So I briefly explained them, but you could definitely get more information online, and definitely I'm not a person to be able to comprehensively compare these different software. Then we focus specifically on RSTAN. We explain different elements, and then we have four examples so that you guys can work and apply it RSTAN. I tried very much to have something hands-on that you can work on your own, like the previous introduction to R. But I think I was not successful enough, and this might be a little bit of lecture more than before. But we'll figure out. So. Let's start with the idea of Bayesian analysis. So Bayesian analysis starts with the simple Bayes rule, that if you are interested in a conditional probability of theta given y, this based on Bayes rule can be written as probability of y given theta times probability of theta divided by marginal probability of y. Okay. And what does it mean? We have some parameters that are unknown. We don't know what those parameters are. We observe data, then we want to estimate those parameters. What frequentists do, they assume a distribution on some data. Like we are interested in high school students, a common example that I have all the time, and assume that those are coming from normal distribution. We don't know parameters of that normal distribution. So what frequentists do, they collect data, they look at this data, and try to estimate those parameters in the sense that we get the maximum probability to observe this kind of data. So in that sense, parameters are fixed unit that you estimate. Like suppose that we have a common sigma, we have the mean parameter, we observe data, we look at this data, maximum likelihood estimate in this case is mean, we look at mean, and mean of those data is an estimate for a parameter. Okay. So in Bayesian framework, it's a little bit different than you start with some prior belief about a parameter. So you have some ideas, you have done some work before, you have read literature, you know that this parameter is usually within this range. Like we are interested in estimating body temperature. So you know that body temperature is like within the range. It's not from negative infinity to positive infinity. It's not like from 0 to 200. It's within a range. So you have a prior belief. And you have a target group, you start collecting data on that target group. And then you update your belief based on what you learn from those data. It's not just based on data. Also, depends on your belief. Okay, so it's very interesting in that sense that you can combine prior belief into your analysis. If you have done many work before, other research areas, people work on that, you can combine those information into data. It's not only based on data. Okay, so I can summarize this. So this one, so parameter of interest actually is this theta. And Y is the data that we observe. If you look at the denominator does not depend on any parameter. So when we have the data, denominator is a fixed value. Okay. So we can get rid of the denominator, and we can have something like this. Instead of having a denominator and an equal sign, we have a proportional sign here. That probability of theta, parameter of interest, after seeing the data, is equal to, we had a prior belief, we observed data, we updated our belief, and we got something we call a costume. So you start with a prior belief, you observe data, you update your belief, you got a costume. It's basically the idea of Bayesian statistics. And of course, this is the joint probability of theta and y. Okay, so the whole question and the whole goal in Bayesian statistics is now how we can characterize this posterior distribution. Do we know the distribution? Is it easy to get the distribution? So our goal is to get the posterior distribution. P theta given y sometimes may have a closed form. Like you have a belief, it's in the form of a probability distribution. You observe data, and these data are from a distribution. You multiply them together, you get a closed form probability for posterior. That is basically updated after visiting this data. In that case, it's very easy. You have a distribution, it's known, and you can sample from that distribution. And the best way to characterize a distribution is to sample that. Like you have a normal distribution, how we characterize it, you can have the actual distribution. Another way is to sample 1,000, 10,000, 1 million samples, and you can just have a simple histogram or estimate density and see how it looks like. But in many cases, the problem is the posterior distribution is not known. It doesn't have any name. We cannot analytically work with that. It's difficult to deal with that distribution. And then the question is, if you have a difficult distribution, then how we can characterize that, how we can sample that. We don't know even what that distribution is. So the idea is how we can sample from that target distribution, from that posterior distribution, so that we can characterize the distribution of this updated belief about the parameter of interest. Okay. Any questions so far? Okay. So how to, now in cases that we don't have a closed form distribution for posterior, how we sample from the posterior. We have two ways, MCMC and variational base. Variational base is a very new idea. With MCMC, Markov chain Monte Carlo, you can come up with an algorithm that, you start with a Markov chain, you can come up with an algorithm that the target distribution of this Markov chain is the distribution of interest. Okay, so you start with a point and you continue, and over time you will reach to a stationary distribution, and that distribution is this distribution of interest. If you go there, if you wait for enough, you know, number of iterations to reach to that the stationary distribution, then all the samples are from this part and probability of theta given y. Okay, so this is the idea of MCMC. Variational base is if posterior is very difficult, we cannot characterize posterior, let's come up with an easy known distribution or class of distributions that are close to that target distribution and a sample from those. So this idea is actually very popular these days, as with many machine learning problems, if you apply Bayesian, sometimes some of the MCMC methods are not scalable, especially when you have big data. And if you can find some type of distribution to estimate the posterior, it's very easy and very handy to sample from this, rather than wait for a long time, a lot of number of iterations to sample from the posterior or a associated distribution. So you can learn more about the MCMC method from an article on MCMC from machine learning, a very interesting paper. So now focusing on MCMC methods, that those methods help us to sample from the posterior, the different MCMC methods. Okay, we can have Metropolis-Hastings algorithm. How many of you are familiar with Metropolis-Hastings? Okay, so with Metropolis-Hastings, the MCMC method, at each step, you propose a new value for parameter. And then you decide whether to accept or to reject that parameter, Okay? So you have the posterior, you know posterior to some constants, because you can evaluate likelihood, you can evaluate prior, so you know posterior to some constants. With the Metropolis Hastings, you propose a new value for theta, you decide whether to accept or not. If accept, you go to the next one. If not, and reject, you continue getting the previous value. And this is a very common method to do Monte Carlo MCMC. Okay, again, you want to sample from posterior, you start with MCMC. Sometimes it takes a long time to reach to a stationary distribution. Once you reach that stationary distribution, in other words, you converge, then you start sampling and treating those samples as samples from the posterior distribution. Okay, so the first step that we need to wait until we reach the stationary distribution is called warm-up or burning. After that, you sample from a posterior distribution. And these samples tend to be correlated. They're not independent samples. Usually we work with IID samples, identically independent identity distributed samples. Samples from Monte Carlo are correlated, but there are theorems that explain why we can use them. You know, and then we are not going to talk about those, but just so you know. And gift sampling, sometimes a parameter is a problem is a big problem. It's not just one parameter, it's not just mean or standard deviation. We have many, many parameters. And gift sampling, based on the idea of looking at parameters conditionally, you can incorporate Metropolis Hastings by looking at parameters conditionally. Like at each step, you can work on updating one parameter given the current values of all previous parameters, all other parameters. And then you can update this parameter, you get a new value for this parameter, you go to the next parameter in your problem, and for that parameter, given all the rest of the parameters, you update a new value. Slice sampling also is another technique. Reversible jump, slice sampling and Metropolis Hastings are like a reversible jump as well. Reversible jump is when you change the dimensionality of the space that you're looking at. Okay. And Hamiltonian Monte Carlo is another MCMC method. Stan uses Hamiltonian Monte Carlo, which you can learn more about Hamiltonian Monte Carlo. I have a link here. But why it's important to use Hamiltonian Monte Carlo in the stand as opposed to Metropolis Hastings or a gift sampling that is using other Bayesian software is in Metropolis Hastings, especially if you have a posterior that samples are very correlated, okay, you tend to be stuck in a region over the posterior density and you don't move that much. Okay. Or it takes a long, long time for you to move to another region because these are highly correlated, you're stuck in a place, so that you cannot explore the posterior distribution as fast as Hamiltonian Monte Carlo. Hamiltonian Monte Carlo reduces those correlations and can directly jump to points on the distribution that they have higher density. So they are more plausible.
If we reduce the relation between different data, so will we reduce the also reduce the you know the efficiency the accuracy of the estimation?
You mean reducing the correlation?
It's fast, but it may consume some accuracy.
Well, you know, here in Bayesian method, you can sample as many as you want. Okay, but you know, like suppose that you have a density. You know, it can be a density like this, or in two dimensional, you can have densities of type this. But suppose that you are stuck in a place and it takes you a long time to move. Whereas with a Hamiltonian Monte Carlo, you can go to different places and then come back, so you can explore the whole distribution faster, rather than sucking in place and moving very small, you know, moving tiny step in every situation. So in some cases that we don't have highly correlated samples, Hamiltonian Monte Carlo and Metropolis Hastings are not, you know, in gift sampling are not that different. But in cases that we have high correlation, hematite Monte Carlo is very faster in exploring the posterior density. It's interesting that in stand user's manual, they explain that for a problem, a deep sampling took them hundreds of thousands of iterations and did not converge. But with under 1,000 iterations, they can converge to Hamiltonian Monte Carlo. So if you have high dimension, Hamiltonian Monte Carlo is definitely to go. And converging is a big issue, especially if you have large number of parameters. Okay, so, you know, like the goal of this workshop is not to explain all of these methods in detail. And maybe I'm not the person to perfectly explain all these, but just want you to know that we have these methods and you know, to have some ideas. With all these methods, there is a tuning step that is usually very difficult. Now, like if you have a Metropolis pacing algorithm, you want to know how big your steps should be. If your steps are too big, you always reject because these are not possible. You jump too big or too high. If your steps are very small, you are not moving fast enough and you have a very high acceptance rate, but you are not moving fast enough. So it's always challenging to find a tuning parameter for the step size, especially if you have many parameters in your problem, and all these software automatically take care of that tuning, and that's a great thing. We also have tuning parameters for Hamiltonian Monte Carlo, and the stand automatically tunes them. So these are three main softwares to do Bayesian statistics: Winbox, OpenBox. I think Winbox is not supported anymore, but there's another project called OpenBox. Winbox used to be only for Windows. Still with OpenBox, it's not easy to work with Mac and Linux, especially with Mac. And you need to have a software called Wine to somehow simulate Windows and work with that. But this program has been around for the past decade. And you know, the name Box stands for Bayesian using deep sampling. And a gift sample is if we have many parameters, we do conditionally. At each point, given all other parameters, we update one parameter and we go to the next parameter. JAG, just another gift sampler, is very similar but written completely different. You know, the idea is similar to Box, but with a different implementation. And you can use JAX in all platforms, including Mac and Linux. And STAN is the newest one among all these three, developed in Columbia University. And you can, again, use STAN for different platforms. You're going to focus on STAN today. And what is a STAN? A modern language in which statisticians could write models with a familiar notation that we learned in R. And the STAN automatically translates and compiles them in C++, so they are fast, way faster than R. And the STAN does all the tuning part. The STAN uses HMC as opposed to GIF sampling. And you know, for HMC, you have one parameter is called the number of steps, and that's also a tuning parameter. The STAN uses something called no U-turn sampler to make sure that we are not passing a maximized point, so that you can get more information by reading about Knott's algorithm. So for STAN, we have different interfaces, including RStan, PyStan for Python, CommandStan. We also have for Stata and MATLAB. We are going to focus on R1 today. How many of you have installed RStan? Great, perfect. Sometimes it's a little bit hard to see. So where to get help? They have a very, very good user manual. Version is 2.8, very useful. It's not something like, you know, they also have R vignette, but it's not something that you go and see what different functions they have and what parameters are. You can actually learn by looking at this. And there are different implementations of different models. You can go, if you're interested in specific model, like I'm interested in Gaussian processes, you can go and see an example of Gaussian process in the stand and have your own. You also have a user group on Google that you can ask questions. I wanted to start with one stand example so that we see what components we have in that example. And then later learn what those components are. You know, first have some ideas of how we implement the stand and then learning about that. So consider a simple example of tossing a coin. If you toss a coin, one coin, you either get head or tail with probability p. Let's call a Bernoulli example, Bernoulli distribution 0,1. If you toss 10 coins, you have summation of independent Bernoullis, and it's called binomial distribution. Y is the number of heads that we got in a binomial process. I suppose that we did it n times. Okay, beta is the probability of success, or p. Mm-hmm. Y of them were success, so we get a probability of theta to y. Mm-hmm. And the rest of them were failure. 1 minus theta to n minus y. In Bayesian framework, suppose that we need to estimate probability. Is it a third point with probability 0.5? Or is it a different point? It's a biased point, and the probability is not 0.5. We need to estimate. Frequently, they sample model, like a random model, like they flip a coin 50 times, when 24 of them, or 20 of them, are head, 20 divided by 50 is an estimate for theta. Okay? In Bayesian framework, we have a prior for theta, we observe data, we update our prior. Suppose that our prior on theta probability is beta distribution. Beta is limited between 0 and 1, jives with the notion of probability. Okay, with alpha and beta parameters. We start with this prior. We believe that theta has this distribution. You may think that my theta is uniform. I have no clue that whether it's closer to 5 or closer to closer to 0.7, 0.5, 0.3, I consider a uniform probability that everything from 0 to 1 is equally plausible. So a uniform prior, right? And we observe data, we update our prior. Okay. So in a Bayesian model, you can just write the formula for p theta, beta distribution, easy to write the formula. Write the formula for p bar given theta. P bar given theta is a binomial distribution with theta parameter. Multiply them together, so you get a formula like this. If you summarize this, you get a new beta for the posterior. That is updated. Initially, your theta parameters were alpha and beta. You now update your parameter, alpha plus number of success, and beta plus number of failure. So you have a new probability for your theta. Okay. So let's simply write this one into R. Known posterior distribution. And in specific, in this case, we call priors a conjugate prior. There's a family of the prior distribution and posterior distribution are similar, so we call it conjugate prior. So I toss a coin 200 times. I assume that it's a biased coin. So the probability of success is 0.4 rather than 0.5. And I sample my bias. So I start with R binomial, so in order for you guys to get similar result, you can set seed to whatever you want, but if you do 1, 2, 3, 4, you know, sometimes it's kind of system computer specific, but sometimes not. So, and I sample y's. Y's are coming from a binomial distribution, or back to Bernoulli distribution, binomial. So, out of 200, 75 of them were head. 75 in your head. If you were a frequentist, you could estimate theta as 75 divided by 200. 75 of them are ahead, and 200 is the total number of tries you had. I define a prior alpha equal 2 and beta equal 2. And if you want to know what these priors are, you could sample from your prior, a sample from beta distribution, a sample 1,000 number or 10,000 numbers. Where the first one parameter is alpha and the second parameter is beta. I can create a histogram of this. I guess I'm like this. Okay. So based on my prior, I think it's less plausible to have a very small or very large scale. More plausible to have a beta in the middle. It's my prior belief, not a beta. Okay. So. And I know that the Poisson distribution. The Poisson distribution is basically another beta with the first parameter as the prior parameter plus number of success, and the second parameter is prior parameter number of failure. Okay. And I can simply sample. This is the estimate that I get. Okay. And it can. Actually, there's a useful package called CODA in R to do convergence diagnostics, including plot for Bayesian analysis. You can install library CODA, and I can do plot my samples. So I get something like this, that I did a lot of sampling. It seems that it's converging. Yeah, if you see something like going down, of course it's converges because we know the actual Poisson distribution. But in general, if you do, and this plot, by the way, is called trace plot. If you do trace plot and you see going up and down, it's not converging yet. And then you can see it corresponding density plot, and it's mainly around 0.4. Okay. So this is a simple case that we know the Poisson distribution, and we can easily run it. Now, my goal is to write a STAN model. Okay. STAN does not care whether it's a conjugate prior or not. STAN does not derive the closed form formulas. STAN does the same thing. So it's not, when you define a prior, sometimes in Bayesian statistics, we focus on priors that we can get conjugacy. So we can sample without pain of updating and checking conversion and stuff. It's not a case with the STAN. It can come up with any plausible prior. Okay. So there are three steps in STAN. Most of it is not in R. The R part is very simple. Just very simple function and then initializing. The main part has STAN has its own language, which is very similar to R. It has like a combination of R and C++. But it's very similar to R syntax. We're going to focus on that. But you saw with writing a program in STAN, and you save that as a text file or as a .stan file. And then in R, so this is the part that you do in STAN, step two and three are the part that you do in R. You initialize data and run the model. By running, I mean the STAN compiles your model that you wrote here, does the initialization, for the data, as well as initial value of the parameters, and start sampling. Okay, so let's look at an example of a STAN data, STAN models for a similar example. We have different blocks. We're going to soon see what those blocks are. But here we have a data block, parameters block, and model block. Data is what we read from the data. Now we have data. That's in the data block. We read it into R. We don't do any calculations. We don't do any sampling. How many options, how many trials we tried? We did 200. And unlike R, that you never specify type of the variable that you are working with, since this is going to be translated into C++, you need to mention explicitly what that type is. So N is a primitive type of type integer. And you can set a lower bound or upper bound. You put constraints. So something that's very useful for a STAN to know that this constraint, especially for parameters. And minimum value is 1. Of course, at least 1 trial. In this case, 200 trials. Y is our data, number of heads that we observe. Alpha and beta are the prior that I use for theta. So my theta We're from a data distribution with a known alpha and known beta. Okay, known prior parameters for theta. So these are known, and I know the type, these two are real, n and y are integers. Okay, so this is the data part. Parameters, what parameter or parameters I'm interested in sampling? In this case, theta is a parameter that I do sample, probability of getting head. And the model is the part that you mentioned, the likelihood and the prior. Theta is going to be beta distributed with alpha and beta that are known. And I have alpha and beta. Okay. And my model, y's, are coming from binomial distribution with n and theta. This is basically p theta, the prior. This is the likelihood, p by given theta. And the standard knows all the stuff, knows that it should do sampling for theta, and runs them up. Any question? Is it clear? Okay. And how we run it in R? We create a list of data, how many n, what y, what value of alpha and beta I'm going to choose for my prior, and then I fit my model. Very simple, that use a standard function, you refer to the code that you save, and dot, you know, that can be dot text, that can be dot stand, you know, whatever you want to use. And the data, the input data, when I run it on one chain, I do 1,000 iterations, and my warm up is 200. Okay. So the first 200, I call it pre-convergence. This is a very simple case, and it should converge really fast. But I call the first 200 as pre-convergence.
So what if you have multiple y's? What if y is an array or a list?
Yeah, exactly. We have. I'm going to talk about different ways of specifying y. But for this simple example, y is just one number. Okay. And if y is a list, again, you do y equal y, or y is a list, but you need to handle it in your standard program. I'm going to talk about that. Okay, and chain, I only have one chain. Usually it's a good idea to start, but then how you start with chain, you start with some initial values for the parameter, and then you run your code on the conversions. Sometimes the initial value might be important into what position distribution you convert, to what value you convert. So it's always a good idea to have multiple chains, so you start with many different starting points, and then you can compare chains. If it's converging, regardless of where you start, you should converge to the same distribution. And then you can here. And so this is stored into a fit, and you have different operating, different functions in R that you can run and fit, like somebody summarizes the fit, you can print it, you can and look at the trace plot, and there are different options. Okay. Any questions so far? So let's see the R section part, which the initialization is very simple. The stamp function does these things. It translates the stamp model into C++ code, then the C++ code is combined into a shared binary that can be used in the R section, and then finally we do sampling based on that combined files. And this compilation include using and tuning parameters to do HMC sampling. Which is really difficult. So, I think the last one is, if you compile a model and then later you decide to have different number of chains, different initial values, or different number of iterations, there's no need to recompile it. So compiling sometimes takes time. But there's no need to recompile it, we can refer to previous compiled files and run it with the new settings. Okay, so in R, there are different functions, summary of the sample parameter, including log probability, prints the result, trace plot, extract, the fit that you get from STAN may include many parameters. With extract, you can extract those parameters that you're interested in. And finally, there's a nice function called non-shiny STAN, and you can have a shiny interactable web that you can run on your feet. And you can try this on your own. I'm going to cover this. Okay. So the most important part is the stem level that you write. And again, as we saw, it's very straightforward. It's not something complicated. But it's more work to do compared to the R part. We saw introducing the stem's program block. Remember that we have data, we have parameters, we have model. So we're going to see how many data blocks, how many blocks in general we have in stem, and how to specify them. Data types, variable declaration and statements, what different data types we have, operators and built-in functions, how we multiply matrices, do we have any element-wise multiplication stuff. You can have your own function. Some stuff that I think are important to think about, like how we can reparameterize a model, how we can do change a variable, and if we do, how we should deal with that in the stem. What happens to truncated data? What happens to sensitive data? And finally, I have some examples that you guys can try on your own. Any questions so far? These are the blocks that you see possible to have in stem program. So functions and the order matters. You should follow the same order. Okay. You can move them around. Okay. Functions is a block that you, if you have your own function, you define your function within this block. Data is a place that you have your input data inside, and you define variables that read those input data. Parameters that you are interested in sampling. Transform parameters, you don't always need to have everything sampled. If you sample theta, there's no need to sample one of the theta. If you sample theta and beta, there's no need to sample theta plus beta. Okay, so then you can set those transform parameters here. Model, you mentioned your prior, you mentioned your likelihood. Generating quantities is the last block. Okay, so explain function blocks. It's important that data is only read once. The data are read once. You know, they're not over and over again. It's not a block that gets repeated. Okay. And in the data block, you cannot have any statements. If you have y and you have n, you cannot do anything like z equals y divided by n. You can do any statement, you can do conditional statement, you can do any assignment. It's just for reading data. And as we saw earlier, for different variables, you can have lower bound, upper bounds, and stuff. And then you can have type. Those should jive with the input data. You cannot have non-negative n and have inputs negative n. Okay, and the stem figures it out. So again, within the same range, and they also should have the same type. You can't have a vector of length 10 and then have an input of 20. Transform data block, so similar to transfer parameter, you can have transform data. You can do, you're reading data, there's no way that you can do any statement in the data block, but later in the transform data block, you can do a statement, you can define new things based on the data that you already read. Parameters block is a place that you put parameters that you sample. And again, similar to data, you cannot assign anything. Transform parameters, as I mentioned, there's no need to sample everything. Once you sample some parameters, and you can derive other parameters based on those samples, you can mention them into the transform parameters, which is a function or a statement of the previously sampled parameters. Model block, you have likelihood and prior. Generated quantity block, sometimes in your Bayesian analysis, you do all the sampling, then you want to summarize the result. You generate cluster mean, critical region, you want to do prediction based on already sampled data, you generate random numbers, and you use those estimated parameters to do some prediction. You can do all the things in generated quantities block. This is run after finishing sampling. So data types and variable declaration. three data types. The simplest one, primitive data type, that values, variables can be real or integer. Okay. And they can also be constraint, as we saw, with lower bound, upper bound. Two options only, real and integer. Okay, compound data type, we can have vector, for everything under compound, vector or matrix, they are assumed to have real values. There's no integer value. Okay. In the parentheses, STAN does not do any sampling on discrete parameters, which is not the case with bars and with jacks. So you can do more discrete as well. But with STAN, so far, you can't do any sampling for discrete parameters. So compound data types, we have vector, we can have row vector, we can have matrices. Like the first one that we had, constraint, lower bound, upper bound, here we can also have constraint, but the type of constraint is a little bit different. Here we can have simplex. Like instead of having the vector of length 5, we can have a simplex of length 5. So we are putting constraints that this vector is a simplex. All values are between 0 and 1, and sum of over these 5 values is 1. So by saying that we have a constraint, that this vector is a simplex constraint. We can have a unit vector, it's a vector, but the norm of this vector is 1. It's a unit vector. Order, positive order. We can have a correlation matrix. So when we say correlation matrix, it's not a general matrix for a STAN. STAN knows that it's positive definite, it's symmetric, and it has one on the diagonal. So it's very helpful because when you do inverse of a matrix, if you know these features of a matrix, inversion of a matrix is much faster than a general matrix. Okay, so and these are very helpful for us. And you can do Kolaski factor covariance and correlation. Now sometimes if you work with multivariate normal, you know that sampling from multivariate normal sometimes is difficult. And if you do Kolaski decomposition on the covariance matrix, you can do it faster. So these are all the things that you can do with STAN. The last one is array. You can consider array with list that we saw earlier in R, that we had some constraints, but when we had list, we can have different things of different types and stuff. So array, one example, three-dimensional array. So we have an array with three different cells, and each cell is integer. Or we can have four dimensional arrays of row vectors. We can have an array with four cells. Each cell is a row vector by itself. Okay. It's like combining different types. Okay, so I have some examples here that simplest one, variable n is of type n. You can see theta vector, this is how we define a vector. My deck is a vector of length 3. And my vector now has a constraint. All the elements within this vector are non-negative. And I have theta, and this is a simplex of length 5. For matrix, again, I can put constraints that this is a general matrix of dimension 3 by 3. A correlation matrix of 3, so when you say correlation matrix, STAN knows that it should be a square matrix, so there is no need to have two dimension, it's 3 only. Sigma, and I have the Kolaski factor correlation, so that's 5. And again, this is square. Now, let's look at here. Int n5 is an array of 5, of length 5, with the cells are integers. And this is different from how we define vector. Vector of 3, and this is the name of vector. Array of size 5 of type int. So since that we have name of the array, length of the array, and the type of each cell in the array. Okay. So if you look at this one, this is also, we have an array, and this time we have two dimension. So again, this is different from matrix. So we have an array of 3 by 4, and each cell is of type real. So it's have the same explanation for the last one. We have an array, it's called new, of length 3, and each cell by itself is a vector of length 7. Okay. So you see that this actually is the type of each cell within that array.
Any question? Is it clear? Can everyone see this bottom? No? No?
What's the double backslash for?
Oh, this is actually a good question. This is actually to write comments in. No, in R we do hashtag. In C++, understand, which is based in C++, we do this backslash. Forward slash. Never learned this.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. So, let's talk about statements. What types of statements we have? We can have assignment statement. We can have sampling statement. You know, remember sampling statement is when you say y is from the binomial distribution. That's a sampling statement. We can have log probability increment statement. For loops, conditional statements, and print. So, assignment statement similar to R. And arrow one, we need to end every line with a semicolon. This again is C plus plus plain value. In R, when you hit enter, R knows that this is a new command, new line. Here, spaces don't matter. You need to do semicolon. And sigma, we go to the first cell of the sigma and assign one. Again, instant first ID for an array, for a matrix, for a vector. These are these start from one. Start from zero. Even if you suppose must be some zero. We have a sampling statement, y is coming from a normal distribution with mu and sigma. Non-probability increment statement. Stan considers all probabilities in log format. Okay. So log is interesting because one big issue in many Bayesian codes is sometimes you get overflow or underflow. Okay. And handling this is sometimes difficult. That you get a value, it's not plausible, but it causes the density to be positive infinity or negative infinity. And having positive infinity or negative infinity in your calculations, you know, makes a mess. You need to handle it, it's difficult. So when you go to log format, there are ways to handle overflow and underflow. And Stan does that for you. And everything is in log format. So when you say y has a normal distribution, Stan works with the log normal. Log of the normal. Okay? So in other words, if I write a likelihood, like suppose that I have called likelihood. I write P1 times P2. We don't care what P1 and P2 is. Okay. Instead, you can work with log of L, which is summation of log of Pi. Right? In this case, P1, log of P1 plus log of P2. So Stan works with the second one, working with log and summation of logs. Okay. So if you have a vector of Y, and these ones are IID. Okay, so you start from the first one, and you know what? Let's write it. You write the likelihood for y, and that is you observe n data points, and for each you have the probability or the density, and you get the likelihood as multiplication of these. Okay, if you work with log. This is going to be summation of log fi. Okay. Now consider log L as the log likelihood, starting from zero and have a for loop from one to n on i's. The first one, you add log of fi, f1. And then you go to the second subject or second observation, you add log of f2. And you keep adding to get this summation. Okay? We are incrementing log probabilities. So instead of having something like y is normal with some parameters, we can use increment log probability to do exactly the same. Okay? Same likelihood, instead of getting that from a distribution, at each point we increment the log probability. So the question is, why do we need that? And in fact, if you have a distribution, it's better to mention the distribution rather than log increment. And the reason is, when you write the distribution, the stand knows that it should throw away all constants, because those constants do not matter in calculating posterior. But when you do log increment, you have all those constants inside. And it's slightly faster if you do distribution. But log increment is handy when you have a likelihood that it's difficult to specify in terms of known probabilities. You can have your own likelihood, and you can increment that with log probability. We are going to see an example. And that example actually is based on inflated Poisson. Inflated Poisson, we don't have a very easy distribution to say y's are coming from inflated Poisson, zero inflated Poisson. But you can easily write the likelihood using increment log probability. Basically the same, in a different way than the distribution. For loops, similar to R, very simple, except that we have the semicolon. We didn't have it before. Do we need to write yn like this? Y1 to yn, they are normally distributed. Should we do in a loop? No, Sam understands that. Is it important to write them in the vector format? For C++, it's not like R, that if you write it in vector format, you get a lot of speed, wide efficiency thing. So in terms of computation of a loop versus a vector, for C++ is not a big deal. But for a stack, if you know everything in a vector, writing the likelihood is faster and better than doing iteratively. So you always gain if you do it in a vector format. There are cases that vectorized way is not available. We are going to talk about those. But if you can, write it in a vector format. Conditional statements, as before, simple. You do if condition and statement. And I assume that these statements include semicolon by themselves. You know? And I had a separate semicolon, but inside that statement we have semicolon. Print, stand does not have a stepwise debugger, but you can do print. Okay, and this is a very old traditional way of debugging Bayesian code, that you put a print, and anytime you sample a value, you print it and you see whether that's plausible or not. You can do exactly the same thing with stand, and there's a function print. And you can do, wherever you can write in a statement, you can put prints there. But there are some blocks that you repeat them more. Like, in data, I'm just making up data block, we can't really write the command. But if you look at transform data, in transform data, you can have a statement. So transform data is not repeated many times. So if you do print, it's not getting repeated. But if you do print in transform parameter, and you can also have statements, then you see print more. Every time that you call that block, you see. Okay, this is an example that I have in transform data, a simple print that I print, and this is like a paste thing that we had before, and we print UN. So this is basically, if this is one, we get something in quotation mark U parentheses one, and then we print the value of U1. Okay, hopefully it's not too boring for you guys so far. Sorry it's not. We are going to see some examples, but sorry we haven't had that many examples so far. You can have operators. We have logical operators. I have listed them. You have arithmetic operator. If you do dot that thing, then you see element wise. So here dot this element wise division, tick point or to get transpose of the matrix, and then in user manual you can get all functions and operators that are implemented, that have been implemented in the standard. Okay, there are many built-in functions. I have some examples of built-in functions, like the determinant of the matrix is inverse. Inverse, when we know that the matrix is symmetric positive definite, which is way faster than the inverse in general for general matrix. Eigenvalues, and there are many other built-in functions. Again, I highly encourage you to look at the user manual. Very, very helpful, very helpful. Okay. Any questions so far?
Is the slides online?
Yeah, they are. If you download the repository, they're online. Yeah, I made some changes like 2 hours ago, but I didn't get time to.
I downloaded the zip folder, but how can I open these things? I just cannot see it clearly from here.
Okay. No, I didn't upload the most recent one, which was 2 hours ago, but I have like from that time to open it. Yeah. For you to open, there is an HTML file, and you should be able to open HTML file. You cannot open HTML?
You can just double-click the RMI file on GitHub.
Okay. Oh, great. Thanks. You could actually double-click on the RMD file in the GitHub.
Yeah, you can do that too.
Yeah, exactly. You could also run that RMD file.
Oh,
I don't have
to.
Any other questions?
There's a package called slide file.
Okay, user-defined functions. And you can have user-defined functions in stack, and when you define functions, make sure that you follow C++ rules. It's a little bit different from R. In R, you don't have to mention the type of the output. You know, if you look at a function in R, you guys know.
RCP.
Like simple RCP. Function in R. Like simple function in R, you have a keyboard function, and you have a first variable, and you have a second variable, and then you can simply return A plus B. You don't mention anything about the type of the output that you are returning. You don't have anything about type of the input arguments, and you don't have semicolon. And of course, you don't have function here. In C++, it's a little different. You have the type of the output that this function returns, type of the argument, and if you have a function that it doesn't return anything, the type should be void. Again, user manual or stuff like this. Okay. So I wanted to talk a little bit about reparameterization and change of variable. Reparameterization is important because based on statistics, some models, if you reparameterize them, you can better sample and more efficiently sample posterity. So sometimes it's good to reparameterize them. Like, suppose that you have a beta distribution has parameter alpha and beta. Suppose that you can better do posterior sampling when you reparameterize beta into mean and lambda, where mean is alpha over alpha plus beta, and then lambda, which is alpha plus beta, something like that. But the ultimate goal is to sample alpha and beta. Then just reparameterize them to sample better, but the ultimate goal is to estimate alpha and beta. So this is called reparameterization, and change of variable is when you are interested in y, but you know that log of y is normally distributed. You want to sample from log of y. How you can have that back into a y format, which is a typical stats question that if you know a distribution of x, how you can get a distribution of a function of x. So we need to know how to deal with these cases. Okay, so an example here, consider beta distribution with alpha and beta shape parameters, and suppose that a better representation is to define phi as alpha over alpha beta, which is quite a way to mean, and lambda alpha plus beta. Okay, so note that we are sampling from the same distribution, we are not changing the distribution, and the goal is to sample alpha and beta, but we are specifying the model in terms of phi and lambda. So how we can deal with this case? First reparameterization is when we have alpha and beta, the simplest case. our data includes n and y, you know, the same coin example binomial that we have y number of heads, or you could consider y, in this case, you know, the previous one was y as integer with a lower one, but now y is a vector of size n. So instead of looking at number of heads, let's store the whole sequence of 0, 1, 0, 1, no, the first one was head, the second one, tail. That's y. So each one of them is permuted. The whole thing is binary. Okay, so parameters that we are interested in, suppose that are alpha and beta. Yeah, I need to make some changes to this one. This is not the right example. Y's are distributed beta, so I need to change this a little bit. Sorry about that, if you go with me. By the way, this is marked out that we are going to see in the next session. So I'm going to get rid of this guy. Suppose that y, and I change this y into theta. And suppose that it's a vector of n. You could also do 4 here. Yeah, I created all of these slides with Markdown. Yeah. Okay. That's better. Sorry about that. Okay, so suppose that theta is a vector of size n. And by the way, we need to also have n on top of that, because n is not known at this point. But you guys know that we have another like integer n on top of that. And it's a vector of size n, and all the values of theta are between 0 and 1. And suppose that these values are coming from a beta distribution. That beta distribution includes two parameters, alpha and beta. So we want to sample those parameters. So those parameters that we want to sample are alpha and beta, which all of them are non-zero. We can have priors for alpha and beta, and theta, which is the likely part now, is coming from a beta distribution with alpha and beta. Okay, like this is something like probability of alpha and beta given theta, which is what we observe, is proportional to theta, proportional to theta given alpha and beta times p of alpha and beta. Okay. So theta given alpha and beta is a beta distribution with alpha and beta have their own priors. Okay. Here we have a separate prior for alpha and separate prior for beta, assuming that prior on alpha is independent of prior. If A and B are independent, probability of AB joint is equal to probability A times probability B. So in this case, we assume the prior of alpha and beta, their independence of probability of joint is equal to multiplication of marginals. Okay. Now, suppose that we want to write it in terms of the new parameterization, where phi is alpha over alpha plus beta, and lambda is alpha plus beta. Okay, so these are the parameters that we do sampling. We know that it's easier and more efficient to sample phi and lambda as opposed to alpha and beta. So we put them in parameters, and the transform parameters, those that we are interested in, are functions of these two. There's no need to directly sample them. Once we sample these two, we can get those two. Okay, so alpha and beta, alpha is basically lambda times phi. Phi is alpha over alpha plus beta, and this one is alpha plus beta, so multiply them and get alpha back. And beta is lambda times 1 minus phi. Okay, whatever you have in the transform parameters, also going to be printed as output, because these are already indirectly sampled. We sample these two, we calculate this, which means that we also sample these. But SAM doesn't do sampling for those. So this is an example of reparameterization. We parameterize the distribution based on alpha and lambda, but then we calculate based on phi and lambda, and we calculate the parameters of interest. So, again, this is going to be theta, but theta is beta, alpha, and beta, and there is no need to do Jacobian, because this is still based on alpha and beta. We are not sampling log y, or we are not sampling something else and inferring for another variable. This is a simple change of variable, change of reparameterization. Yeah, this might take a lot of time here.
And not only scaling an aggression set of all these things.
We can also see, yeah, okay. I have actually an example of linear regression.
Okay, because it could be like much more profitable to do a little more of examples in the beginning.
Exactly, yeah. I actually have an example of linear regression.
I mean, the parameterization and these things, well, suppose that it's more advanced and we're just running it a little bit.
I see.
I mean, it's important, but perhaps as a second or.
100%. Yeah.
For instance, I'm trying to compile the thing into the board. No offense, yeah, but.
I would think that. Finish the remaining stuff.
Yeah, do your own stuff, but I mean, I could like to see like an example.
Sure.
Like many.
So we come back to slides. Maybe reparameterization and change of variables might be better. But you know, you guys can go over that later, but definitely consider that, because there are. What is the difference between how you look at the models, and you need to specify the models correctly. One thing that I wanted to emphasize on, maybe I was not very successful explaining that, was that even if SAM does a lot of tuning stuff and compiling and sampling, that you don't need to come up with a way to sample from posterior to tune your samplers, but still, you need to have a very good understanding of your model, the type of priors you use, and to specify your model correctly. Now, otherwise, SAM cannot do it. Let's look at truncated data. For truncated data, so we have two types of important data, truncation and symmetry. And instead, when you have data, you can't have any missing data. Okay, so we need to deal with these two cases. Truncation is, you can consider a detector, that detector only detects signals that are larger than a frequency, or a signal that are weaker than a specific frequency. Okay. So anything outside of that range is not detected. The detector doesn't know about it. So only sees what is inside that range. Okay, Okay, we call it truncation. We may see 100 signals out of 1,000, but the detector only knows 100 of them. Has no idea about the remaining 900, because those were outside of the range. And we only have a value, a measured value, for those that are within this range. This is an example of the truncation. So how we deal with truncation in STEM? Suppose that we have n different values, n different signals, and we have an upper bound u, and all signals should be greater than u, otherwise we don't see them. We are interested in assuming that these y's are from normal distribution with mu and sigma. We only observe these y's if they are less than u. Because these y's should be all smaller than u. If they are outside of this, we don't observe them. And the detector doesn't know that there exists any subject with a value outside of that range. Okay. So with truncation, you could simply deal with t and whether you have a lower bound or upper bound. So in this case, all y's should be within a normal up to point u. And this is basically equal to normal distribution that is scaled based on probability up to a point u. Okay, so this is for the cases that we have truncated data. And sensor data is when the detector knows that we have 1,000. Suppose that we have a detector, that detector, or I can have a better example, we follow patients for 5 years. Okay, suppose that we have patients with AIDS. We follow them for 5 years, some of them die within these 5 years. After 5 years, we have no idea about those that didn't die before 5 years. Okay. We know the number of them. We know that some of them died before 5 years, the remaining didn't die, and they had a lifetime greater than this 5 years. But we don't know what exactly that is. This is an example of sensor, which is different from truncation. Okay. Is it clear? Do you see the distinction? Okay. So, in other words, for those that get censored, that we don't know the actual value, those are like missing values. The actual value is missing. Okay. How to specify them in STAT? We can't have any missing value. So then, we can treat them as parameters, and we can sample those as well. So here, that's what we do. We have data. N of them observed, N underscore observed. N underscore censored are the remaining that we know the value. It's not like the truncation that we don't know anything about the remaining 900. We know that we have 1,000, 100 of them observed, 900 of them didn't, we didn't get to observe them. Our data includes only the observed one. So we have a vector of size observed. And we know that the maximum follow-up time was u, and anything beyond u is not observed. Parameters, of course, we are interested in mu and sigma, but we can't throw away those that we didn't get to observe them. Those are information. Okay, so we can consider them as a parameter. Those that are censored are parameters. Okay, and we know that both of them are coming from normal distribution with mu and sigma. Some of them we observed them, the remaining we didn't get to observe, but these guys are parameters, so standard sampling for them. And, okay. And then you can write this in terms of likelihood that I'm going to skip. Okay. So let's work on exercise one. So I have four exercises. Let's see how much time we have. Okay. So I have four exercises. One of them, I have the answers here. So let's work on those examples. You know, find a partner, try to understand this, try to implement it. I can answer questions. And then we take a break, we come back, work on the remaining three, then we continue with partner.
Thank you.
are you on the same slide?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, let me explain something that how you need to. So in order to write those examples, you need to first, in RStudio, open a text file. So you open a text file. This is a place for your SAM program. And you save your SAM program in a directory with .sam extension or .txt. Okay? So once you have your SAM program, you create a new file, and that's going to be an R program. In that R program, you need to initialize the values, data, and you need to use a SAM function that refers to your SAM model with number of iterations. You have questions on what span does, do question mark span. And then once you run a feed, which is a span on your model, you can plot the feed, you can trace plot the feed, or you can trace. Something important is you need to make sure that first, you have your RStand already installed, and the second, to load RStand. Okay. So again, you need to first open a text file, write your SAM code based on what you see in the slides, and then open a new R session, and load that in, or call that with SAM function. I'll be walking around, so I'll ask you questions.